where the White Nile meets the Blue Nile, Khartoum, capital of the Sudan. A poor country chafing under the burden of hosting hundreds of thousands of refugees. We came here for two reasons. First, Israeli officials claim they cannot help Falashas because Israel has no diplomatic relations with this Arab country. Second, Jewish organizations in America say that the Sudanese put obstacles in the way of refugee aid. Sitting on the left, First Vice President of Sudan, Omer Mohamed El-Tayeb, and on the right, Ambassador to Washington, Duner Sabeh Aissa. We asked them whether there was any truth to these allegations.
No, there is no grounds for this at all. On the contrary, we have been cooperating with all voluntary organizations in the United States and with the United Nations in trying to facilitate the departure of any refugees who find another homeland. Their springboard is the Sudan. Some of them have crossed the border to Israel, some of them went to Rome, some of them go to England, and we certainly would be happy to share with any friendly country this burden. It is a burden on the Sudan, it's a burden on our economy, and certainly would very much like to see voluntary repatriation of refugees either to another land or to their country if situations make it possible.
We hope the West will help in receiving some of these refugees, as the ambassador said before, and this will help them for their future. In the Sudan, we are very flexible if they want to leave the country for any other country, especially the West, where they can find better life, good future. Definitely, we will help them, and there are no any obstacles against that.
The case of the Falashas is that they wanted to be repatriated directly from Ethiopia into Israel. We did not actually want to, we didn't want to be party to that, but we welcomed them as far as being refugees. If they cross the border into the Sudan, we welcome them as refugees. If from the Sudan they can arrange to go to wherever they want to, we'll be happy to facilitate that to them in as much as politically feasible for us. But as a whole, if these refugees cross the border in the Sudan, they will have the same treatment, humanitarian treatment that other people had. From then on, if they can make their own contact, be repatriated to another country with which we have diplomatic relations, we welcome that. If they depart to another country with which we have relations, and from then on go somewhere else, it's their business, we must interfere. Yeah, wherever I know they go to Israel. As a matter of fact, there are a number of Ethiopians that I met in the United States, and their route was they crossed the border into the Sudan, from the Sudan they went into Israel, not directly of course, because there's no flights, but they probably have gone into some other country. From that country they went into Israel, and from Israel into Rome, and from Rome into the United States.
New York City, headquarters for the Jewish Refugee Aid Organization, HIA. The Sudanese say the Falashas can go. Leonard Seidemann argues that helping Falashas would compromise secret Israeli rescue operations.
Are you saying there is no role for Hayas to play in the refugee situation?
I would say the role we're playing in the political field is the role that to which we've given the greatest priority.
I'm asking, is there a role for Hayas to play in the refugee situation?
We are playing that role.
And what role is that? Staying out of Israel's way?
No. That's not the way to put it. We are endorsing the fact that what they are doing is the correct approach.
But what I'm trying to get to is not what you're endorsing, but what you're doing.
We are working in the political field.
No, I'm talking about the refugees.
Well, the political field is on behalf of the refugees.
What do you mean then by political field?
Have the United States government try to influence the policies of the governments involved, which make it difficult.
Which government?
The Sudan, for example.
Are you trying to influence the Sudan government?
As well as the Ethiopian government.
We spoke to the Vice President of Sudan, and he said that they are putting no obstacles in the way of any refugees getting out, and he mentioned Falashas specifically.
Well, that's the first time I ever heard that. I never heard that, and I would be glad to try to take it up to pursue that. That's an interesting piece of information you're supplying to me, and if I take the details of that, I will try to pursue it.
But surely, if you're already involved in diplomatic and political efforts, you would have already approached the same people who interviewed.
Our approaches did not produce the answer that you just told me you received.
You spoke to the vice president of Sudan?
No, no, no.
You spoke to which Sudanese officials did you speak to?
I was in Khartoum myself for several weeks, and I spoke locally.
Who?
I can't mention their name.
Professor Lenhoff believes geopolitics explains why Israel has not done all it can.
They had the so-called African policy, started by Golda Meir around 1956, in which the African countries surrounding the Muslim countries were befriended by Israel. And Ethiopia was a prime country there. Now, Eritrea shall not secede. If Eritrea secedes, then the whole Red Sea becomes an Arab lake. And if this is true, both Ethiopia and Israel lose their route to the Persian Gulf, which neither country could tolerate.
מטיסות האלה עלו לישראל 2050. בבטן המטוס הדמויות מהעלתה לבשו צורה וקיבלו קווים מדויקים וברורים. נשים, גברים, זקנים, ילדים בטח. אם תרצו, ספינת מעפילים, או עלייה בלתי חוקית, מודל 87. כך בין השנים 84 ו-87, היו 8 מבצעים חשאיים של מטוסי קרנף של חיל האוויר בסודאן. בטיסות האלה